Thank you. Thank you. हेलो हेलो हेलो, माइक चेक टेस्टिंग 1 2 3। हेलो 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 हेलो, माइक टेस्टिंग 1 2 3। ठीक, हेलो हेलो हेलो, माइक चेक। हेलो हेलो, आवाज़। हेलो हेलो हेलो, माइक चेक। हाँ हेलो हेलो, ठीक है ना, माइक चेक 1 2 3। हेलो 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 हेलो, माइक चेक। थोड़ा सा रिड्यूस। हेलो, ठीक है।
Thank you.
चेक चेक हेलो हेलो थोड़ा सा आवाज साउंड हेलो माइक चेक चेक थोड़ा सा और बस ठीक है
Oh, द नेम ऑफ द राग इज राग शिवांजलि. आई स्टार्ट विद आलाप जो thank you.
गुड आफ्टरनून लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन,
आप सभी को मेरा नमस्कार।
I welcome you all to the 21st G. Ram Reddy Memorial Lecture 2016. Well, today is a very important day for the entire IGNU fraternity, as we gather here to remember very fondly our beloved and our first founder, Vice Chancellor of IGNU, Professor G. Ram Reddy. In order to commemorate the memory of such a legendary educationist and our founder Vice Chancellor, we hold the Professor G. Ram Reddy Memorial Lecture every year on the 2nd of July, which also serves as a platform to enrich and enlighten our academic pursuits by inviting eminent speakers from varied and diverse fields. On this note, I welcome our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Ravindra Kumar, our chief guest, Professor J.S. Rajput, Dr. Sanjay Baru, who will be delivering today's memorial lecture, Professor E. Vayunandan, Chairman of the G. Ram Reddy Memorial Committee, and our Registrar, Mr. Sudhir Budakoti.
मैं स्वागत करना चाहूंगी श्रीमती प्रमिला जी राम रेड्डी जी का भी, जिन्होंने अपनी व्यस्तताओं के बीच से हमारे लिए समय निकाला और आज के इस कार्यक्रम के लिए वे हमारे बीच उपस्थित हैं। हम आपके बेहद आभारी हैं मैडम। मैं स्वागत करती हूँ इग्नू मुख्यालय तथा भारत भर में स्थापित 67 क्षेत्रीय केंद्रों पर उपस्थित सभी विशिष्ट अतिथियों, संकाय सदस्यों, इग्नू के अधिकारियों, कर्मचारियों तथा अपने सभी साथियों का, आप सभी का स्वागत है।
दिस प्रोग्राम इज बीइंग वेबकास्ट लाइव अक्रॉस द वर्ल्ड एंड इट कैन बी वॉच्ड एट http://webcast.gov.in/ignu. I would now request our honorable guests to please be seated at the dais. Our chief guest, Professor J.S. Rajput, Dr. Sanjay Baru, our honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Ravindra Kumar, Professor E. Vayunandan, and Shri Sudhir Budakoti.
हमारी संस्कृति में किसी भी कार्यक्रम का शुभारंभ कुछ खास रीति रिवाजों से करने का चलन रहा है। ये रीतियां हमारे अंतस के भावों को प्रकट करने का माध्यम होती हैं। दीप प्रज्वलन हमारी उसी सांस्कृतिक धरोहर का एक हिस्सा है। मैं श्रीमती प्रमिला रेड्डी जी, आदरणीय कुलपति जी, हमारे आज के कार्यक्रम के सम्माननीय अतिथि, कार्यक्रम समिति के अध्यक्ष तथा कुल सचिव इग्नू से अनुरोध करूंगी कि हमारी इसी परंपरा को आगे बढ़ाते हुए दीप प्रज्वलित कर आज के कार्यक्रम का शुभारंभ करें। तमसो मां ज्योतिर्गमय, दीप अंधेरे से उजाले की यात्रा का प्रतीक, दीप अज्ञान से ज्ञान की ओर विकास का प्रतीक, दीप उम्मीद की नई किरणों का प्रतीक, दीप हमारे इतिहास से लेकर भविष्य तक के पथ पर निस्वार्थ मार्गदर्शन का प्रतीक, दीप हमारी हम सब की अपनी संस्कृति का प्रतीक। प्रोफेसर जी राम रेड्डी स्मृति व्याख्यान हमारा अपनी जड़ों को पलटकर देखकर सीखने, नमन करने और आगे बढ़ते जाने का जरिया है। हमारी अपनी बौद्धिक और अकादमिक विरासत को जानने और समझने का जरिया। 21वां प्रोफेसर जी राम रेड्डी व्याख्यान इसी श्रृंखला की अगली कड़ी है।
I would now request our honorable guests to please offer their floral tribute to Professor G. Ram Reddy. Professor G. Ram Reddy, a great leader, a distinguished scholar, a humble and modest person, an epitome of knowledge. IGNU pays its homage to this towering personality.
Ma'am, आपसे अनुरोध है कि आप दो मिनट मंच पर बने रहे. प्रोफेसर मैम जी प्रमिला रेड्डी मैम.
मिसेस रेड्डी प्लीज.
आज के कार्यक्रम में अपने प्रमुख अतिथियों के स्वागत के लिए हमने नन्हे नन्हे पौधों को चुना है. मैं सबसे पहले अनुरोध करूंगी प्रोफेसर गीता केकर जी से कि वे नन्हा सा यह पौधा देकर श्रीमती प्रमिला रेड्डी जी का स्वागत करें. अब मैं अनुरोध करूंगी आदरणीय कुलपति जी से कि वे आज के हमारे प्रमुख वक्ता और प्रखर मीडिया विशेषज्ञ डॉक्टर संजय बारू जी का स्वागत करें. मेरा अनुरोध है प्रोफेसर कपिल कुमार जी से कि वे छोटा सा यह पौधा देकर हमारे आज के मुख्य अतिथि प्रोफेसर जे एस राजपूत जी का अभिनंदन करें. गमले के बीच खिलखिलाता नन्हा सा यह पौधा कुछ और नहीं, हमारा आपके प्रति आभार व्यक्त करने का एक माध्यम भर है. आप सभी का आभार.
मे आई नाउ रिक्वेस्ट प्रोफेसर ई वायुनंदन, चेयरमैन ऑफ द 21st जी राम रेड्डी मेमोरियल कमिटी, टू प्लीज डिलीवर हिज वेलकम एड्रेस.
Very good afternoon all. I welcome you all to this 21st Professor Ram Reddy Memorial Lecture. And we all know that for last 20 years we are organizing this lecture and inviting eminent speakers to give certain, use this platform for higher education and distance education in particular. So this year also we organize this 21st lecture. So we have invited Dr. Sanjay Baru to deliver this lecture, and he has taken a topic about the leadership and try to compare Professor Ram Reddy and Narasimha Rao. I'm very thankful for Sanjay Baru for accepting our invitation and delivering this lecture. And I too belong from Usman University. It is a very emotional, also a sentimental, plus also a honor and privilege to associate, with this lecture and also late Professor Ram Reddy, because I was a student of Usman University and student activist when Professor Ram Reddy was the Vice Chancellor. Fortunately, I was also lecturer when he was the first Vice Chancellor of this Indira Gandhi National Open University. So it's a very emotional, and I also thank Professor Ravindra Kumar for making me the chairman of this committee. I also welcome Professor R.S. Rajput with a short notice, and we tried to contact him, and he accepted our invitation. And I once again thank him. In a short notice, he has accepted and for this occasion. And coming to the Mrs. Premila Ram Reddy, I think this, I mean, every year, I think university, I mean, we are trying to have this lecture, and always we find that university was kind enough to continue this kind of lecture over the years, I mean, which has become more and more, it became more important, okay, I mean, event. So in the process, we find always Mrs. Primila Reddy, who we used to contact her to grace this occasion. And she was kind enough to come all the way from Hyderabad and attend this occasion and add a kind of a respect to this lecture. With this few words, I welcome again all the staff at the headquarters, at the regional centers, and various places who are watching this, lecture. Once again, I thank you. I now request the Honorable Vice Chancellors to give the presidential address.
आदरणीय प्रोफेसर जे एस राजपूत, डॉक्टर संजय बारू आज के प्रमुख वक्ता, प्रोफेसर ई वायुनंदन आयोजन समिति के अध्यक्ष, श्री सुधीर बुढ़ाकोटी विश्वविद्यालय के कुल सचिव, श्रीमती प्रमिला रामरेड्डी हमारी विशिष्ट अतिथि, इस सभागार में बैठे हुए अन्य गण्यमान्य अतिथि तथा सभी मित्र, विश्वविद्यालय के लिए 2 जुलाई का दिन कृतज्ञता दिवस है। ये वो दिन है जिस दिन हम अपने विश्वविद्यालय के संस्थापक कुलपति, प्रथम कुलपति प्रोफेसर जी राम रेड्डी को याद करते हैं, उनकी स्मृति में एक व्याख्यान माला का आयोजन करते हैं और देश के तमाम प्रबुद्ध साहित्यकारों, बुद्धिजीवियों को इस व्याख्यान माला में व्याख्यान देने के लिए आमंत्रित करते हैं। आज हमारे विशेष आमंत्रण पर श्री संजय बारू यहाँ आए हैं। मैं उनका परिचय आप लोगों को दूं, इसके पहले एक बात बता देना ज़रूरी समझता हूँ कि संजय बारू जी एक प्रबुद्ध बुद्धिजीवी होने के साथ साथ प्रोफेसर जी राम रेड्डी से व्यक्तिगत रूप से जुड़े हुए थे, और अभी जब मैं वहाँ बैठा हुआ था तब उन्होंने मुझे प्रोफेसर जी राम रेड्डी की स्मृति में प्रकाशित हमारे पुस्तकालय द्वारा एक छोटी पुस्तिका है उसमें प्रकाशित एक समाचार की तरफ मेरा ध्यान आकृष्ट किया जो संभवतः उन्होंने इंटरव्यू प्रोफेसर जी राम रेड्डी का लिया था। ये संयोग है कि वो इंटरव्यू पुस्तकालय ने इस पुस्तिका में प्रकाशित किया है। कृतज्ञ होना हमारी संस्कृति का अभिन्न भाग है, और अगर हम कृतज्ञ नहीं होंगे तो हम उत्तरोत्तर प्रगति की तरफ बढ़ेंगे भी नहीं, क्योंकि हम अपनी जड़ों को अच्छी तरह समझें और इस बात पर गर्व करें कि हमें ये जड़ें कहाँ तक ले गई हैं, कितना विशाल वटवृक्ष खड़ा हो गया है प्रोफेसर जी राम रेड्डी द्वारा रोपे गए उस छोटे से बीज से जिसको इंदिरा गांधी राष्ट्रीय मुक्त विश्वविद्यालय के नाम से आज हम जानते हैं, जो सारे विश्व का अग्रणी विश्वविद्यालय है। विद्यार्थियों की संख्या के लिहाज से भी ये विश्व के सबसे बड़े विश्वविद्यालयों में से एक है। उस वटवृक्ष की छाया में बैठकर हमारे लिए ज़रूरी होता है कि हम उस व्यक्ति को याद करें जिसने ये वटवृक्ष लगाया और जिसके प्रयासों से ये अपने आरंभिक दिनों में संजोया गया, संवारा गया और आज इस तरह पुष्पित पल्लवित हो गया है। हम सब उसकी शाखें हैं। ये वो समय भी है जब हमें थोड़ा सा ये आकलन भी कर लेना चाहिए कि विश्वविद्यालय ने पिछले 28-30 वर्षों के दौरान किस तरह की प्रगति की है। एक विस्तृत समीक्षा का समय तो ये नहीं है, लेकिन हमें इस बात पर गर्व होना चाहिए कि दूर शिक्षा के क्षेत्र में, मुक्त शिक्षा के क्षेत्र में इंदिरा गांधी राष्ट्रीय मुक्त विश्वविद्यालय इस समय सारे विश्व में एक जाना पहचाना नाम है। इसके विषय में बहुत सारी भ्रांतियां, बहुत सारे छोटे लेख इलेक्ट्रॉनिक मीडिया पर तरह तरह की बातों को यदि हम नज़रअंदाज कर दें तो हम आपके सामने दो तीन तथ्य ज़रूर रखना चाहेंगे। एक महत्वपूर्ण तथ्य ये है कि कुलपति के रूप में पिछले दो महीनों के दौरान मुझे जहां कहीं भी जाने का और देश के विभिन्न लोगों से मिलने का अवसर मिला है, उसमें से एक ने भी विश्वविद्यालय के प्रति किसी तरह का संदेह या दुर्भाव व्यक्त नहीं किया, बल्कि हर जगह हमें विश्वविद्यालय के प्रति आस्था, विश्वास और यह आशय देखने को मिला कि यह विश्वविद्यालय देश के अग्रणी विश्वविद्यालयों में से एक है और मुक्त शिक्षा के केंद्र में तो निश्चित रूप से ये इस देश का सबसे प्रमुख विश्वविद्यालय है। हमें इस बात पर गर्व होना चाहिए, हमें इस बात के लिए सतत प्रयासशील होना चाहिए कि इस तरह की छवि को हम और निखारें। हमें इस बात के लिए निरंतर लगन के साथ जुटे रहना चाहिए कि ये छवि और प्रखर हो और यह वटवृक्ष जो अपने मूल तने के साथ आज खड़ा हुआ है वो सैकड़ों छोटे छोटे तनों के रूप में देश के हर हिस्से में फैल जाए। जिस तरह का हमारा रीजनल सेंटर का तमाम नेटवर्क है उससे ये बात तो हम विश्वास के साथ कह सकते हैं कि ये विशाल वटवृक्ष देश के अनेकों अन्य भागों में भी उसी तेजी से पनप रहा है, पल्लवित हो रहा है जैसा कि यहाँ हेडक्वार्टर्स पर हो रहा है, जैसा कि दिल्ली के इस प्रमुख स्थान पर हो रहा है। एक बात हमें और ध्यान देने की है, विश्वविद्यालय एक समेकित ऊर्जा से आगे चलता है। विश्वविद्यालय क्या, सारा विश्व एक समग्र ऊर्जा के माध्यम से आगे बढ़ता है और सारा विश्व ही क्या, सारा ब्रह्मांड एक समग्र ऊर्जा के माध्यम से आगे बढ़ता है। और ये ऊर्जा हम सब जानते हैं कि धनात्मक भी होती है और ऋणात्मक भी होती है। कोई भी ऊर्जा पिंड ऐसा नहीं होता जिसमें केवल धनात्मक ऊर्जा हो या केवल ऋणात्मक ऊर्जा हो। धनात्मक और ऋणात्मक ऊर्जा के एक सुंदर संयोग के माध्यम से ये ऊर्जा पिंड सारे विश्व को, सारे ब्रह्मांड को संचालित करते हैं। हमारा विश्वविद्यालय भी यदि एक ऊर्जा पिंड है तो इस तरह की धनात्मक और ऋणात्मक ऊर्जाओं के संयोग से मिलकर बना हुआ विश्वविद्यालय है, ये ऊर्जा पिंड है। इसलिए हमें ये ध्यान रखना चाहिए कि धनात्मक ऊर्जा को हम निरंतर प्रश्रय दें, सराहें, संजोएं, अपने साथ लेकर आगे बढ़ें, उसको खाद डालें, मिट्टी डालें, पानी दें और ऋणात्मक ऊर्जा के प्रति हमेशा सचेत रहें। उसके प्रति सचेत रहना इसलिए आवश्यक है कि ऋणात्मक ऊर्जा में यह प्रवृत्ति होती है कि वो धनात्मक ऊर्जा द्वारा किए गए तमाम रचनात्मक कार्यों को उपहास का पात्र बना दे अथवा उनके प्रति एक नकारात्मक दृष्टिकोण से सबको भर दे। एक दृष्टांत मैं आपके सामने प्रस्तुत करता हूं। विश्वविद्यालय ने आज से कुछ समय पहले इस बात के लिए सचेत होकर कि जल हमारी परम आवश्यकता है और उसके संरक्षण के लिए हमें निरंतर प्रयास करना चाहिए, सारे विश्वविद्यालय में छोटे छोटे ऐसे गड्ढे खुदवाए जहां वर्षा का जल संचयित किया जा सके और ये जल पृथ्वी के अंदर जाकर हमारे जल भंडार को और प्रचुर करे। पर ऋणात्मक ऊर्जा वाला संवर्ग एक विभत्स दृष्टिकोण के साथ इस जल संचयन को कब्रगाह तक मानने को तैयार है। इसलिए हमें इस बात के लिए सचेत रहना चाहिए कि ये कब्रें नहीं खुली हैं, ये जल संचयन के लिए छोटे छोटे प्रयास किए गए हैं। ये वही प्रयास हैं जिन छोटे छोटे प्रयासों के माध्यम से प्रोफेसर जी राम रेड्डी, प्रोफेसर कुलंदई स्वामी, प्रोफेसर राम ताकवले और ऐसे ही अन्य कुलपतियों ने इस विश्वविद्यालय को सजोया संवारा है। उनके संवेद प्रयासों का परिणाम है कि आज हम लोग इस सभागार में बैठे हैं, इस विश्वविद्यालय का यह कुटुंब हमने बनाया है और ये निश्चित है कि यह कुटुंब बनाने में धनात्मक ऊर्जा का जो सहयोग रहा है वो ऋणात्मक ऊर्जा से कई गुना और कहीं ज्यादा समृद्ध रहा है। मुझे बोलने के लिए 5 मिनट का समय इन लोगों ने दिया था। मैं समझता हूं कि मैंने वो प्रारंभिक बातें जो इस तरह के आयोजन के लिए, इस तरह के समागम के लिए आवश्यक होती हैं, आपके सामने प्रस्तुत कर दी। हम सब मिलकर इस बात के लिए प्रयास करेंगे और मैं आपके साथ साझेदार रहूंगा उस प्रयास में कि हमारा विश्वविद्यालय जिस संकल्पना के साथ प्रोफेसर जी राम रेड्डी ने स्थापित किया था उस संकल्पना को और प्रचुर समृद्ध और पल्लवित पुष्पित करे और ये वटवृक्ष न केवल भारत का बल्कि विश्व का एक विशाल वटवृक्ष कहलाए। धन्यवाद।
धन्यवाद सर, आपने सही कहा कि विश्वविद्यालय समेकित ऊर्जा के माध्यम से आगे बढ़ता है और इग्नू ऊर्जा के खूबसूरत संयोग से यूं ही आगे बढ़ता रहे ऐसी हम कामना करते हैं।
Our chief guest today, Professor J.S. Rajput, is a well-renowned personality in the field of education. He has made numerous contributions in the reforms of school education, teacher education, and institutional management. He was appointed full professor of physics at the age of 31 years in 1974. He has even served as the principal of the Regional Institute of Education, Bhopal, joint education advisor, MHRD, chairman, NCTE, and as director, NCRT. He has also been awarded with the prestigious Jan Amos Comenius Medal for outstanding contribution in research by UNESCO in 2009 and the Maharishi Ved Vyas National Award in 2012 by the government of Madhya Pradesh. Currently, he is the member of the Board of Management of IGNU. Sir, we are privileged to have you here with us. I now request you to come and say a few words.
Esteemed Vice Chancellor, Professor Ravind Kumar, esteemed Dr. Premda Ram Reddy Ji, Dr. Sanjay Baru, Sri Sudhir Badakoti, Sri Vaiv Nandan, distinguished colleagues and friends, I feel honored to be here on this occasion. I had the privilege of interacting with Dr. Ram Reddy on a couple of occasions. During my 3 visits to Commonwealth of Learning in Vancouver and one, I think, in an African country, I was proud to hear about Dr. Ram Reddy, about IGNU. हालांकि मैं चाहता था कि एनसीईआरटी के बारे में वैसी बातें करें लेकिन मुझे अच्छा लगता था। आई फेल्ट इलेटेड व्हेन प्रैक्टिकली फ्रॉम एवरी कंट्री समबडी हैड समथिंग टू से अबाउट प्रोफेसर राम रेड्डी। यस, वी नो इंडिविजुअल्स प्रोड्यूस ग्रेट इंस्टीट्यूशंस एंड इंस्टीट्यूशंस इन टर्न प्रिपेयर मोर एंड मोर ग्रेट पर्सन। Dr. Ram Reddy had a vision. He anticipated what would happen after 10 years, what would happen after 20 years, what would be the requirements of the generations ahead. And he gave a concrete shape to it, whether it was this institution or the Commonwealth of Learning, where in the initial stages he had tremendous contributions, and of course, later on in UGC also. Well, we have a tradition. You recall, one person, Madan Mohan Malviya, Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya, created an institution. And this institution has contributed so many great persons. We had the Vidyapeeth established by Mahatma Gandhi. We had the Shantiniketan by Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore. We had the Aligarh Muslim University and a couple of more I can mention. But the essential point is, on today's occasion that I must mention, I'm overwhelmed by one particular respect. You had established an empathetic relationship with Professor Reddy, and the way you honor him, the way you show respect, indeed indicates that institutional commitment and institutional loyalty must be respected, and you are following that age-old Indian tradition. We know, and I personally also know, how many people love their university. Dr. Reddy, the way he is being remembered by IGNU, in fact, could be a learning experience for many other institutions. Well, friends, you are preparing not only the young, but even those who are not too young. But on the whole, the young of today enter a world. For every generation, when the young enter the world, it is a different world, a new world and all that. But now, the world in which the young of today enter is a very complex world. And indeed, not only complex, it is changing at such a fast pace, that it's difficult to imagine what would be the shape of the world after 10 years, 20 years. And that, I think, is the crux. How do you prepare men? How do you prepare the future generations, men and women, who will be able to cope up with the change, who will become the part of the change, and who will bring about the change? The capacity to analyze the change and to find out what is the best suited to us is one of the skills that you would be developing. You would not be developing only the knowledge and the skills, but also you would be remembering, and I think you have remembered all along, that it's a man-making education. It is not a cliche. It is something which is very necessary in a world which Dr. Kothari used to say, never before we had so much of knowledge, so much of resources, so much of means of communication. But unfortunately, on the other side, never before we had so much of distrust, so much of violence, and so much of wars, so many of wars. So this is a very contrasting world, very complex. And therefore, you need to develop the total personality. And whether it is in any area, any course, any program, this has to be kept in mind. Another point that came to my mind was, Professor Ram Reddy was a leader of young persons, leader of the nation, intellectual leader of the nation. He interacted with very significant people. And that, I think, is a learning experience for all of us. Dr. Radhakrishnan wrote a very famous sentence, intellectual work is only for the intellectually inclined. Now what happens when people come to this sector of activity, universities, higher education, research, and innovations, many of them, even if they are initially not that much inclined, do become inclined at a certain stage because of the peer impact, and because the impact that environment creates. I think that has to be kept in mind, because you are a leadership institution. You have to provide institutional leadership. You have become a model of leadership in institutions. You have to further augment your ways, your mannerism, your strategies to ensure that this particular thing that is happening throughout the country, decline in higher education, decline in education, decline in the quality of education. Who will come and check this rod? It has to be an institution like yours. Your area is not confined only to open and distance learning. It is education as a whole. And I think that particular point has to be kept in mind. Well, you have a responsibility to prepare leaders. You have a responsibility to find out and to let others know what is the difference between academic leadership and bureaucratic leadership. Academic leadership has to be encouraged in these institutions, not only in courses and programs, but also in institutional management. Here, the highest in the hierarchy doesn't expect respect. They command respect by their work, by their acting as a role model, by the values to which they adhere to. It is all by example. It is all by values. It is all by devotion. It is all by commitment. I think these are a couple of points which make me say that institutional management is an art, not a craft. And this one sentence says a lot, how to move ahead and how to find out the road to further excellence. I would simply say that an institution like IGNU has done wonderful work. But there is a small proverb, those who do good work, only they are expected to do better work. So that is something which I would like to say in the end. You have done wonderful. You have played your leadership role very well. But I would ask, why have you not done better than this? Maybe in years to come, there will be more laurels, more recognition, and those two terms which are very significant, quality and credibility. These are the key factors, and if you, these are the objectives, I'm sure the whole world will recognize you further, and they will salute your achievements in the end. Once again, as it has impacted me to remember Professor Ram Reddy like this, is a great institutional culture which you have developed. May this culture flourish and this university really get its name, fame, and recognition, the topmost university in distance learning, open and distance learning, in education technology, and in value education and providing humanistic ways to education globally, not only within the country but outside. Thank you very much for inviting me.
Thank you, sir, for very holistically putting forth your views.
प्रोफेसर जी राम रेड्डी का जीवन शैक्षिक जगत के लिए विशेष रूप से प्रेरणादायी रहा है। शिक्षा के जगत में उनका योगदान हम सब के लिए पथ प्रदर्शक रहा है। इंदिरा गांधी राष्ट्रीय मुक्त विश्वविद्यालय के संस्थापक कुलपति प्रोफेसर रेड्डी राजनीति विज्ञान और लोक प्रशासन के प्रतिष्ठित विद्वान रहे हैं। भारत और अन्य विकासशील देशों में उच्च शिक्षा के क्षेत्र में उनके योगदान ने उन्हें विश्व में ख्याति प्रदान की। शैक्षिक जगत में विभिन्न संस्थानों की स्थापना से लेकर विभिन्न महत्वपूर्ण पदों पर काम करते हुए उन्होंने शिक्षा जगत की भरपूर सेवा की। COL की अंतर्राष्ट्रीय दूर शिक्षा परिषद ICCI द्वारा प्रोफेसर जी राम रेड्डी को प्रदान किया गया सर्वोत्कृष्टता पुरस्कार उनके दर्शन और योगदान को विश्वव्यापी पहचान दिलाता है। हम में से कई ऐसे होंगे जिन्हें प्रोफेसर रेड्डी के साथ काम करने का और उनसे सीखने का अवसर तो नहीं मिला, लेकिन उनके जीवन, उनके अनुभवों और इग्नू के विकास के प्रत्यक्षदर्शी होने के माध्यम से हम प्रत्यक्ष अथवा परोक्ष रूप से उनसे सीख रहे हैं और ताउम्र सीखते रहेंगे। प्रोफेसर जी राम रेड्डी को विनम्र श्रद्धांजलि अर्पित करने के लिए हमारी मीडिया टीम ने उनके जीवन पर एक वृत्त चित्र का निर्माण किया है। मैं समस्त यूनिट के प्रति आभार व्यक्त करते हुए उनसे अनुरोध करूंगी कि वे फिल्म का प्रदर्शन करें।
I come from a lower middle class family. It's from a village, and I am the first generation literate.
This is the story of the man who revolutionized the higher educational system in India by ushering in a new philosophy of education, the open and distance system.
On December the 4th, 1929, the small village of Mailaram welcomed the birth of a child, Kadam Ram Reddy.
Vari ki vari nanagar peru G. Krishna Reddy, vari talli peru Kantamma, vari ki muggur santanam. అయితే వారికి వ్యవసాయం ఉండటం వలన కొద్ది 400 ఎకరాల వ్యవసాయం ఉంది. అందులో పంటలు పండించేవాళ్ళు.
As a typical rural boy of the pre-independence India, the little Ram Reddy grew up with fond attachment to his roots and remained a true son of the soil.
The young Ram Reddy learned basic Urdu and Telugu script in an informal school run by a private tutor. Young as he was, he had to leave the comfort of home to pursue education in a nearby town of Karimnagar.
Who would have imagined then that this same boy would later bring education to the very doorsteps of his village and to every other village in India?
He enrolled in a government high school, and very soon he became one of its best students.
Well, in those days, the medium of instruction in Hyderabad state, the former Hyderabad state, used to be Urdu. Though the school was small, educationally it was certainly big. Good teacher start and good company of students also.
In the year 48, he appeared for Aligarh Matric and then, you know, some intermediate afterwards.
Determination and dedication had paid off as he became the first from his village to have passed the matriculation examination.
In the year 1949, that same determination led him to the prestigious Nizam College at Hyderabad.
Nizam College was the only English medium college in Hyderabad then. The Nizam College students were very well known in those days, very, very renowned for their communication abilities, oratorial abilities, and also for their scholarly abilities.
He used to be more very often in the libraries. He had a very separate room in our house also, at Hyderabad. He used to live, and once he goes in, he always used to shut the door and study. Always.
He went on to complete his master's in political science at Osmania University, and in 1957 he left for London to study at the London School of Economics.
Somehow or other managed some finance. Not that he was rich, but in those days we came only from villages and from very modest families. He mobilized some resources and went to England. That was a turning point which made him much more scholarly and much more, practical and realistic about matters.
On his return from London, he joined as a lecturer of public administration at the Arts College of Osmania University.
When I came back from UK, I should join the private sector. But under the influence of the Labour Party, we felt that we should not serve the private sector. Therefore, I joined as a lecturer. And once I joined as a lecturer, there was no other ambition except to continue in the profession.
He soon became a popular teacher among students and also colleagues alike.
Professor Ram Reddy was our lecturer. He used to guide us and he used to shape our personality, give us some sort of confidence to us, but that he always did, not directly, more by example, more by suggestion.
And when he came, immediately he started a new course that was in public policy. Professor G. Ram Reddy used to be in the forefront, interacting with the students and talking to them very freely. I think that those were most memorable days which we can never forget.
Then in the year 1977, at a young age of 47 years, he became the Vice Chancellor of Osmania University and served the university in that capacity for 2 terms.
I went to Sri Vangala Varu and told him, "Sir, I have consulted everybody and the name I have to suggest is Professor G. Ram Reddy." And that's how he became Vice Chancellor. And Professor Ram Reddy as vice chancellor was liked by all sections.
And when I met him, the first question I asked sir was, sir, you have so much service left and this is for only 3 years, what he will do afterwards? Immediately he told, professorship is not inferior to vice-chancellorship. So he'll come back as a professor to the department. That's what he told. And when I became vice-chancellor, I used always in my meetings, whenever there was an occasion, I used to tell Professor Ram Reddy said this.
Professor Ram Reddy's contribution to higher education as a whole has been significant, but perhaps he is most remembered and cherished as the man behind India's open and distance education.
He realized that the conventional systems have actually been gotten into a point of saturation where one needed to begin to look at alternative structures, institutional structures, and that's how this open university idea came up. That has also coincided with the time when the British Open University became a success in the late 60s, early 70s, throughout 70s.
This visionary leader gifted the country with its first open and distance university in 1982, the Andhra Pradesh Open University, which was later renamed Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Open University. With this, he had opened up a never-before opportunity for education, aided by the latest developments in technology.
The establishment of Open University in 1982 is the result of two conditions. One is the vision, competence, and persuasive abilities, and contacts, and sincerity of purpose of leader like Professor Ram Reddy. And second condition is the idea is the idea of times.
The country, having seen the impact and possibilities of the open and distance education in educating the huge population of the country, Professor G. Ram Reddy became the obvious choice of the Government of India in formulating and initiating a national open university. Thus, in the year 1985, the Indira Gandhi National Open University was born under his able leadership.
Open University se desh ke kone kone tak shiksha pahunchegi. Isme koi line nahi lagi hogi ki khali jo kai hazar ki fees de sakta hai wo bharti.
When the National Open University, Indira Gandhi National Open University, was being set up, Professor Reddy was acutely aware of the fact that it is going to be truly a national university. So this whole structure of the national headquarters and the regional centers and the study centers, this whole three-tier structure was visualized keeping in view the national character of the Open University.
And I have no doubt in my mind that this university will leave impression on the educational system of this country.
Some other notable positions he held and contributed greatly included
wherever he went, Professor Ram Reddy immediately took up new schemes. He was an original thinker.
Professor G. Ram Reddy lives on, not only in the work he has done, but also in the memories of those he touched.
He was a very family man, doted on his children and wife, and made it a point to spend a lot of time with all of us whenever he was in Hyderabad.
And I could see him solve critical problems very easily. I think he had a charm which I really cannot tangibly quantify. even today, though I'm a leading pediatrician and a director of a hospital, when somebody introduces me to another person, they say that he's so and so, but the tagline would be son of Professor Ram Reddy. And that's the reflected glory that I still cherish.
He was extremely humane. And whenever he spoke with his mind and heart together, not individually.
He is going to be remembered for a long, long time as someone who changed Indian higher education system qualitatively.
I always feel even now his blessings are there for with us all the time.
I believe that you should be loyal to your people, to your friends. Then another value which has shaped my life is you have to be positive in your approach. And this is what I have followed in my administration, whether in the college or department or in the universities. On the whole, it has paid rich dividends. Here and there, you receive setback. This has been basically my approach to life.
I thank the MPC team at IGNU for such a wonderful picturization on Professor G. Ram Reddy's life. It is an honor for us today to have amidst us Dr. Sanjaya Baru, who is currently Consulting Fellow for India and Director IISS, and Honorary Senior Fellow at the Center for Policy Science and Research, New Delhi. We at IGNU feel proud of sharing a short film on Dr. Sanjaya Baru, showcasing his talent and expertise, which has been prepared by our very own team, the EMPC IGNU. Can we have the film, please? Our chief guest for 21st Professor G. Ram Reddy Memorial Lecture is a name that's not bound to an elaborate introduction. Dr. Sanjaya Baru, a name that's fearless and articulate when it comes to expressing his bold views and is an inspiration to budding minds soaked in politics. He's one of India's most respected and influential commentators on political and economic issues. His continued productive years have seen achievements experiencing heights in all the fields that have been touched by him, ranging from media advisor to former Prime Minister of India, Dr. Manmohan Singh, to Director for Geoeconomics and Strategy, IISS London, to name a few. It is our honor to welcome Dr. Sanjaya Baru to this 21st Professor G. Ram Reddy Memorial Lecture.
करना चाहूंगी कि वे आए और अपना वक्तव्य दें। आज के व्याख्यान का विषय है राम रेड्डी और नरसिम्हा राव, नेतृत्व महत्वपूर्ण क्यों है? राम रेड्डी एंड नरसिम्हा राव, व्हाई लीडरशिप मैटर्स। स्वागत है।
మిస్సెస్ రామరెడ్డి గారు, మిస్టర్ వైస్ ఛాన్సలర్, డాక్టర్ రాజ్పూత్, లేడీస్ అండ్ జెంటిల్మెన్, ఐఎమ్ రియలీ డిలైటెడ్ టు బి హియర్ దిస్ ఈవినింగ్. ఐ రియలైజ్డ్ వెన్ ఐ సా ద బుక్లెట్ దట్ ఐఎమ్ ప్రాబ్లీ ది ఫస్ట్ స్పీకర్ ఇన్ దిస్ సిరీస్, ద 21st స్పీకర్, బట్ ద ఫస్ట్ స్పీకర్ హూ వర్క్డ్ విత్ ప్రొఫెసర్ రామరెడ్డి. You had one more speaker, Dr. D.N. Reddy, a couple of years back, but I'm not sure whether he was teaching at Usmani University when Professor Ram Reddy was the Vice Chancellor. But I had the privilege of actually teaching there when he was the Vice Chancellor. I must compliment IGNU for sustaining such a high-powered lecture series. I've seen all those who have spoken here before. It's been a pantheon of some of our best minds in this country. So I feel particularly privileged to in fact be in this long distinguished list. I agree with Dr. Rajput when he said that the greatness of an institution lies in how it celebrates its own memories, its own leadership, its own past. We in India often forget those who have built institutions and are enthusiastically involved in celebrating those who currently head institutions. But I think it's very, very important to pay tribute to the founders of some of our great institutions. I therefore deem it a great privilege and honor to be invited by the Indira Gandhi National Open University to deliver the 21st Professor G. Ram Reddy Memorial Lecture. I knew Professor Ram Reddy both as a friend of the family. He was a close associate of my father. In fact, one of the gentlemen in that film we just saw was my father. He was my first boss. As Vice Chancellor of the Usmani University, he gave me my first job as a lecturer in the Department of Economics in 1978. As a child, I used to play in the famous Arts College building, and you saw some nice visuals of that Arts College building. It's one of the great buildings of Hyderabad, built 100 years ago. And to enter that great institution as a member of its faculty was for me a great experience. Over the past three decades, I have quoted to dozens of young PhD students what Professor Ram Reddy told me on the day I was selected. At the end of my interview, I had not yet finished my PhD, and he told me that you better finish your PhD quickly. And then he added, getting your PhD is like wearing your trousers. When you have them, no one notices. When you don't, everyone does. I think it's still useful for every young person doing a PhD to get his trousers quickly. I have little hesitation in saying that Professor Ram Reddy was perhaps the last great vice chancellor of a once great institution. As a student and a teacher at Usmania, I do pray and hope that that university will regain its glory and once again enter the ranks of India's great universities. It is a tribute to Professor Ram Reddy's academic brilliance and administrative acumen that he went on to become an innovator in the field of Indian education by becoming the first vice chancellor of India's first open university. And you've just seen a film on his great contribution, so I will not waste your time repeating his pioneering role, and I would call him the father of distance education, the father of the open university system in India. He succeeded my former boss Manmohan Singh as the chairman of the University Grants Commission, and in the booklet that's been kept on the chair, I noticed that I interviewed him for the Economic Times in 1993 when I was there, and he was chairman of the University Grants Commission, and that's been reproduced. It brings back memories of a very long association with Professor Ram Reddy. Professor Ram Reddy was not only a good teacher and a popular teacher and a popular research guide, as some of his students who are here will testify. He was also an able administrator and a true leader in the field of education. The pioneering work he did in spreading the idea of distance education in India stands testimony to his leadership qualities. Great institutions are made by good leaders. And a good leader is one who invests in building institutions rather than perpetuating personality cults. In honoring Professor Ram Reddy today, we honor both his qualities of head and heart and his leadership qualities. He was an institution builder like many of the great vice chancellors of the past century. There is much we can learn today from the experience of academic leadership in institutions of higher education in India during the 20th century, both before and after independence. Be it the imperial government of the British or the feudal regime of the Nizam in Hyderabad or the governments of democratic India, they were able to build good universities by attracting good talent and extending autonomy to university administration. We have had great people like Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan, C.D. Deshmukh, K.N. Raj and so on, people whom I've had some personal association with, who are all great institution builders and great vice chancellors. We should worry that for some time now, university leadership is being threatened by a variety of social and political forces that have weakened higher education, destroyed great institutions, and curtailed academic freedoms. The sway of politicians and bureaucrats on academic institutions has increased. In part, the academic community is itself responsible for this. It has not done enough to command society's respect and regard and done little to keep political interference at bay. Even in an educationally enlightened state like Kerala, it used to be said that if one university is headed by a Nayar, another has to be headed by a Christian and a third by a Muslim. In the undivided state of Andhra Pradesh, my own home state, it used to be said that vice chancellorships were decided on the basis of caste and regional affiliation. What is worse is the growing governmental interference in the functioning of universities of higher education. We have all heard complaints of how a university vice chancellor has to virtually beg for time to meet a joint secretary in the Ministry of Education. I wonder how academic leaders like Professor Ram Reddy would have survived in this environment of bureaucratic and political overlordship. The problem is not confined to one state or associated with one political party. It has become a national menace. The declining quality of academic leadership and willingness of heads of institutions to kowtow to powers that be, powers of the day, bosses of the day, is equally responsible for this depressing state of affairs. This crisis in higher education is exemplified, among other things, by the tens of thousands of students who spend rupees to buy dollars to go overseas for higher education. I belong to the tail end of the nationalist generation to which Professor Ram Reddy too belonged, who chose not to go abroad or went only for brief periods. To be fair, those who went abroad at the time did so more because of the pull factor of the attraction of studying overseas. But today, many bright young Indians go abroad to study because of the push factor of the distortions in the development of higher education in India. A committee appointed by the Union government has recently come forward with a report on a new education policy. We have seen such reports in the past. Hopefully this time, the government will take this report seriously and address the root causes of the ongoing crisis in higher education. Hopefully it will recognize that the problem thus far has not been about policies, it has been about people. Even the best of policies can fail if implemented by the wrong people. That is why, as we commemorate Professor Ram Reddy, we should underscore the importance of individual leadership in the development of higher education. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, ladies and gentlemen, there is one person we must pay tribute to for giving Professor Ram Reddy the opportunity to move from the provincial to the national. And that person is another son of Telangana, comes from the same Karimnagar district that Professor Ram Reddy came from. You saw visuals of the Karimnagar district, and whose 95th birthday we celebrated day before yesterday, and whose silver jubilee of becoming Prime Minister of India we marked this week. And therefore, I've chosen to devote my lecture today to the man who made Professor Ram Reddy, namely P.V. Narasimha Rao. This year marks the silver jubilee of P.V. Narasimha Rao becoming Prime Minister of India. There has been some reassessment of his leadership. His biography has just been published by a very bright young scholar. I've just finished reading it. It's a fine book and I'd recommend it to all of you. But P.V. was not known to this country very much till he in fact became Prime Minister. Though he had been an HRD minister, he had been a foreign minister, he had been a defense minister, he had been a home minister. But his institutional and leadership capabilities came into view in the context of a crisis. I have often been asked how one should evaluate the tenure of a prime minister. And my reply has always been that one must compare the nation, the polity, and the economy that a person inherits the day she takes charge of that job with the state of affairs when one demits that office. By that yardstick, Jawaharlal Nehru was a great prime minister at the end of his first decade in office. His image and legacy were dented by his last 5 years. If Nehru had ceased to be a prime minister in 1957, he would have actually gone down as a much greater prime minister than his assessment is today because of the several mistakes, both on economic policy as well as on national security that he made, the ignominious defeat in the war with China in 62. Indira Gandhi entered history books by supporting the struggle for the liberation of Bangladesh and seeking to improve the performance of the economy in which she failed. We still remember her only by her emergency rather than by her achievements. Rajiv Gandhi and all others who had short-lived tenures of prime ministership have not really left much of an imprint on the course of events of modern history. Narasimha Rao became prime minister at a particularly difficult moment in the history of the country, and he not only steered the country through a period of grave political uncertainty. I don't know how many of you actually have memories of that period. I moved from being a teacher to a journalist in 90 and spent my first 2 years from 90 to 92 on a virtually daily basis writing on what was happening in India. And I can tell you that none of us imagined that we would be where we are today in those dark days. Two prime ministers had been assassinated. India was on the verge of bankruptcy. The Cold War had ended. India's most important ally had imploded. We entered a world that we are unfamiliar with. The initiatives that Narasimha Rao took within a year of assuming office have since defined what I call the post-Nehruvian era in India. The policy shift on the economic front was the more obvious of the changes and the one that has received most academic attention. Less appreciated have been the shifts on the foreign policy front, both within Asia and around the world, and the interrelationship between the two. Finally, there was a new turn on the political front with the era of what political scientists called, I think this was Rajni Kothari who coined the term, the era of single party dominance, giving way to an era of coalitions. 1991 marked the end of an era and the beginning of another. I submit to you that Prime Minister Narasimha Rao defined the post-Nehruvian era even though he was a devout Nehruvian. Nehruvianism, so to speak, was represented by three pillars of self-reliance, mixed economy, and non-alignment. The idea of a mixed economy was intrinsically linked to that of self-reliance. Incidentally, I must add here that my own association with Indira Gandhi National Open University was to write a couple of books for IGNU. And if my memory serves me right, one of those was on the idea of a mixed economy and the role of public sector in India's development. This was, I guess, in late 1980s. Maybe late 80s or early 90s. That's right, Kapil remembers. The idea of a mixed economy was intrinsically linked to that of self-reliance given the small size and relative underdevelopment of Indian enterprise at the time of independence. It was not just that Nehru was inspired by the experience of rapid industrialization in the Soviet Union and by the teachings of Fabian socialism that he was subjected to as a student in England. Nehru was also pragmatic. He shared the view of India's business leaders that for the Indian private sector to grow and stand on its own feet, it needed government support and public investment in social and economic infrastructure. This view was best articulated by a group of eminent business leaders led by J.R.D. Tata, G.D. Birla, and Purushottam Das Thakur Das in a document entitled A Brief Memorandum Outlining a Plan for India's Economic Development, popularly known as the Bombay Plan, and published in 1944. This prescient plan called for a public investment in industry, infrastructure, health, and education. The public sector, it said, should enter areas of vital importance to development, but where private enterprise was either unable or unwilling to invest, and the rest of economic activity should be left to domestic private enterprise. Through the means of a mixed economy, India would become self-reliant and no longer tied to the developed economies of the West. As on so many issues, the Congress was also internally divided on economic policy. While Mahatma Gandhi represented one extreme with his views on self-sufficient village economy and the Khadi Charkha model of development, the Congress socialists were impressed by the Soviet Union state-led model of heavy industry development. A vibrant debate ensued within the ideologically divided Congress on what model of development India ought to follow. Nehru himself adopted an intermediate position, emphasizing the primacy of the state in industrialization, but acknowledging the role of private enterprise, especially in agriculture, but also in manufacturing and services. Nehru's view was best captured by the industrial policy resolutions of 1948 and 1956 that acknowledged that the state has to assume direct responsibility for the future development of industries over a wide area. Having stated this, the policy statement went on to define the sectors where the government would be dominant player and then sought to reassure private enterprise, saying that the development of all other industries will be undertaken through private initiative. While the Nehruvians defined this combination of socialism and capitalism as a mixed economy, its Marxist critics dubbed it as state capitalism, and its free market critics viewed it as bureaucratic socialism. Narasimha Rao preferred the term middle way, using a phrase associated with the Buddha. Narasimha Rao developed the idea of the middle way as a path of moderation, eschewing extremes, in his historic address to the AICC in April 1992, where he quoted Nehru extensively to then redefine Nehruvianism. To interpret Nehru's middle way, said Narasimha Rao, and I quote, as being valid only in a bipolar situation, is not to understand our ancient philosophy of the middle way, P.V. told the Congress. The middle way was meant to be a constant reminder that no assertion or its opposite can be the full and complete truth. It meant that we looked for truth in the interstices of dogma. It means today that we will accept no dogma, even if it happens to be the only dogma remaining in the field at a given moment. Our quest for truth will continue. Having defined his policies thus, P.V. went on to redefine three ideas associated with Nehru, the ideas of self-reliance, mixed economy, and non-alignment. A country of India's size has to be self-reliant, said P.V. But self-reliance did not mean the pursuit of import substitution. The very level of development we have reached has made us, and I quote, independent of the world economy in some respects, but more dependent on it in others. Self-reliance in 1991, PV believed, could be defined as being indebted only to the extent we have the capacity to pay. Reducing foreign debt, being able to avoid default, promoting exports, liberalizing the economy so as to attract foreign investment and earn foreign exchange were all elements that would define the path of self-reliance. In the past, self-reliance had been defined as securing independence from the world economy. Now, self-reliance is being redefined as creating interdependencies with the world economy that would give others a stake in India's progress. I think these are very, very prescient words that are particularly relevant today, as once again a debate is going on the new foreign investment policies of the current government. Next, PV went on to redefine the role of the public sector, reminding his party that both the profits and the losses of public enterprises were in fact the profits and losses of the people of India, making the public sector more efficient so that it would cease to be loss-making was in the interests of the people, of the taxpayer. Further, elaborating the role of public and private sectors in the economy, PV concluded, and I quote, they, which is, that is his policies, do not represent the withdrawal of the state altogether, but a reconsideration of the areas in which it must be present, unquote. And I again mention this because if you are reading what is being debated today on economic policy, these issues are back on the front pages. Finally, PV went on to redefine yet another Nehruvian idea that had been reduced to a shibboleth by our diplomats. Non-alignment was not just about remaining outside antagonistic military alliances. It was not about being neutral. Non-alignment is, and I quote PV, an urge for independence in judgment and action, in exercise of sovereign equality of nations, unquote. As a non-aligned nation, India could be on one side or another in international relations, depending on the issue. While India chooses to be outside any alliance, it retains the freedom to work with one or the other alliance, depending on its own national interest. This was a pragmatic, not an ideological definition of non-alignment. After all, in 1962, it was Jawaharlal Nehru, one of the fathers of non-alignment, who sought American help in dealing with China when it invaded India. And in 1971, it was again Indira Gandhi, another great leader of the non-aligned world, who reached out to the Soviet Union to deal with the US and Chinese ganging up at the time of the liberation of Bangladesh. Linking his economic policies to his foreign policy, Narasimha Rao concluded, and I quote, "This self-reliance must consist in trying to find solutions to our own problems, primarily according to our own genius." That is, this self-reliance in thinking must consist in trying to find solutions to our own problems, primarily according to our own genius. We reject nothing useful for its plainness. We take nothing irrelevant for its dazzle, unquote. Narasimha Rao was a man with words. A few years after PV spoke of the middle way, the British sociologist Anthony Giddens published an influential book titled The Third Way, Renewal of Social Democracy. This book inspired the politics of Prime Minister Tony Blair and today inspires the politics of Hillary's rival in the Democratic Party, Bernie Sanders, of Coburn in Britain, so many Western leaders who are all now talking about the third way of striking a balance, as PV put it, between the individual and the common good. Like the shift away from what Rajni Kothari termed the Congress system in political management, the turn away from Nehruvian economics to what one might rightfully now described as Narasimhanomics occurred through several gradual moves, beginning with Indira Gandhi's decision to enter into a borrowing program with the International Monetary Fund in 1981 and gaining momentum during the tenure of Rajiv Gandhi. Indira Gandhi was not only defensive about her moves, she made much of returning the last tranche of the IMF loan. But a modest attempt to change course would always be viewed against the radicalism of many of her policies. In fact, the so-called license permit Raj and many of the restrictions on business enterprise were post-Nehruvian and contributions of Indira Gandhi. Rajiv Gandhi too was defensive in his liberalization moves, not wanting to be viewed as pro-business. As the economist Jagdish Bhagwati has written, and I quote, "Rajiv Gandhi's reforms were hardly revolutionary in conception or in execution. In retrospect, they amount to an acquiescence in the regime, but a mild attempt at moderating its worst excesses." Narasimha Rao, on the other hand, was unabashed. "The credibility of his initiative," says Bhagwati, and I quote, "was far greater. He was convinced that the ancien regime of the license permit Raj must simply go. In one fell swoop, he dismantled it within a month of becoming prime minister. He became prime minister on 21st June and the license permit Raj ended on 24th July 1991. Rao believed that Indian enterprise would bloom if liberated from the straitjacket of bureaucratic socialism. He was the only prime minister who had the political courage to in fact honor a business leader with a Bharat Ratna when he gave that to J.R.D. Tata in January 1992. After that, no business leader has been given the Bharat Ratna. The third pillar of Nehruvianism, and perhaps its most enduring, which is his foreign policy, was defined by the imperatives of post-colonial economic development on the one hand, and the choices offered by post-war global power balances on the other. India chose to walk on two legs, as it were, on the one hand, befriending nations that would partner its development, and on the other, steering away from Cold War military alliances, while championing the cause of other post-colonial developing nations. Unexpected events like the border war with China and the liberation of Bangladesh, as well as Cold War rivalries, required India to make choices from time to time. But after the clash of 62, as I mentioned, India joined hands with the United States, and after 1969, it signed a treaty of friendship with Russia. The end of the Cold War in December 91 and the implosion of the Soviet Union altered the strategic environment shaping Indian foreign policy. To complicate matters, the delicate power balance in West Asia between Saudi Arabia and Iran was rudely disturbed when Iraq's strongman Saddam Hussein invaded Kuwait in August 1990. India felt the impact of this destabilization as oil prices went up, and of course, many of you would be familiar with the economic consequences of that. India's political leadership had to deal with multiple changes and challenges at home and abroad, and in the context of an extremely difficult balance of payments and fiscal crisis. The manner in which Narasimha Rao dealt with each of these challenges marks 1991 out as a landmark year, a phrase that Eric Hobsbawm coined to define years in which, during the course of the year, you do not realize how important that year is. But with hindsight, we can look back and say why that year was historic. As I said, many of us were reporters or analysts writing on a daily basis on what was happening. It took us some time to realize what exactly had happened in 91. Hobsbawm called 1947 a landmark year because India became independent. Similarly, after 1947, 1991 became the next landmark year in which economic policy, national politics, and foreign policy, all of them undertook a fundamental shift under the leadership of Narasimha Rao. Most informed Indians think only of the economic crisis and its management when they even care to think of 1991. It would seem a vast majority among those who can recall 91 think of it as the year of economic liberalization. Very few, however, would readily recall the political and foreign policy challenges that India had to deal with at the time. In remembering the leadership of Prime Minister Rao and Professor Ram Reddy in their respective fields of engagement, I would like to end with a brilliant quote from Karl Marx in his 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte. And I quote, "Men make their own history, but they do not make it as they please. They do not make it under self-selected circumstances, but under circumstances existing already and given and transmitted from the past. The traditions of all dead generations waste like a nightmare on the brains of the living. And just as they seemed to be occupied with revolutionizing themselves and things, creating something that did not exist before, precisely in such epochs of revolutionary crisis, they anxiously conjure up the spirits of the past to their service, borrowing from them names, battle slogans, and costumes in order to present this new scene in world history in time-honored disguise and borrowed language. Narasimha Rao did precisely that. He quoted Nehru extensively in order to define his moving away from Nehruvianism. I remember his instructing my father, who was one of his speech writers, when he wrote the speech for the AICC in Tirupati, saying in Telugu, he told him, please quote Nehru as many times as possible, because he was actually talking about a shift away from Nehru. That is precisely what Narasimha Rao did. He quoted Jawaharlal Nehru to redefine the Nehruvian legacy. He paid obeisance to Indira Gandhi to undo the economic and foreign policy edifice that she had constructed on top of her father's. He praised Rajiv Gandhi, but showed through sheer hard work and political imagination what a failure Rajiv had been. Mr. Vice Chancellor, ladies and gentlemen, I hope the Indira Gandhi National Open University will remain ahead of our universities in being the fountain of creative thinking, challenging shibboleths, challenging certainties, challenging orthodoxies. I wish you all well as you continue to empower the people of our great nation across its length and breadth with tools of critical thinking, with knowledge and information, with practical training and ability to understand a fast-changing world. Thank you very much.
धन्यवाद सर, आपने ठीक ही संकेत किया कि किसी भी संस्था या संगठन के विकास के लिए सही नेतृत्व सबसे अधिक जरूरी है। मैं इग्नू परिवार की ओर से आपके प्रति आभार व्यक्त करती हूँ। Now the session is open for discussion. आपके कोई प्रश्न या जिज्ञासाएं हो जो आज आप हमारे वक्ता के साथ साझा करना चाहें तो आपके प्रश्न आमंत्रित हैं।
Dr. Baru, you were in the PMO at that time. And that's the time when this entire system of ODL, which had been created over the last almost, I can say, 25 years or 27 years, was dismantled. That when IGNU, which was created by a separate act of the parliament, was converted to be under the UGC. And there have been ample parliamentary reports in that. We have the 227th Parliamentary Joint Committee report. We now have the 217th Sub-Legislation Committee report, which all say that this was a breach of parliament. This was done illegally. That too, at a time when normally we don't allow a person who's on the chair to appoint a permanent person, the statutes were changed and all these things were done. You have seen it from inside. We have seen from outside. We have our own observations that why this was done to IGNU or why it continues to be done to IGNU. Because education, you are aware of the Birla Ambani report, which came way back in 1999, where said that states should completely withdraw from the higher education and higher education should be left to the private players. And now the private sector looks at distance learning system as a milking cow, because they know that both with quality and with money aspect, where we stand today. And we have been under constant attack. Now, I am unable to understand one thing, that at that time when this was done, why the Congress government at that time allowed this to happen, that the world's largest university, which was created in a record time, the students touching 3 million, the university operating in 42 countries, the university creating to such students that even a soldier sitting at Siachen Glacier from there sitting can do a PhD with the university here, can do his courses sitting in the remote corners of Burma border or Assam border in the remotest region doing things over there. Why such a system? was made to destroy. And what is now the future of that system? And the other day I said to one person only, I think we need a Ram Reddy again, who can tell the bureaucrats of today, who can tell the politicians of today once again, that what is the importance of open learning system in this country and for the people of this country, because the people sitting in the policy makers in the last 10, 12 years in education have been illiterate as far as the distance learning system is concerned. They have reduced IGNU again today to the status of that correspondence college, which used to be there. And I'm so shocked that private universities who offer, private MA, their degree is recognized without any support to the student. They just go give their exam, get a degree of done MA in history privately from sub university, that degree is recognized. And the ODL, which is offering all support to the student, the best quality materials. Well, who would have benefited, as you say, that in a classroom only a person will get your lecture, and there are 50,000 students in the country getting your lecture to read what you have written for IGNU. And that university being reduced to these levels, can you suggest a way out? Thank you.
At the outset, my greetings and congratulations to distinguished personalities, Professor J.S. Rajput and Dr. Sanjay Varu. It's a great that, you know, two people have given the direction. And this direction, at the end of your speech, Dr. Varu, what you said is the extraordinary event in the life of IGNU, that you said this is a storehouse of knowledge. And then there is no university in the country that creates a knowledge as much as
the only... Why don't I take some questions from students?
Yeah. The only Indira Gandhi National Open University creates a knowledge, and it has a great future. And towards this, what are the way out when these hurdles? One of my colleague, Professor Kapil, also raised this question. How, from here, with the, given the ICT, the so much of, you know, the development have taken place, from here, way to go, please advise.
Sir, yeah. Good evening. With regard to your speech and the response by Professor Kapil, I would like to highlight only one point, that he puts the whole blame on the bureaucrats, on the politicians, and people who are outside IGNU. But you have, in your speech, you have said that it is the responsibility of the teachers of the university also. And with regard to IGNU, I can straight away say that it is we, the teachers of IGNU, the academics of IGNU, and the non-teaching staff of IGNU, we are all responsible for whatever mess has been created and for whatever status we are right now here. I just wanted to make it a recorder here. Thank you.
I have two brief questions. I'm Professor Ramanujam. I have been working with this university from 1986 as a person who closely worked with Professor Ram Reddy. I appreciate the compliments given by Professor Rajput and also Dr. Sanjay Baru. The first question is to Professor Rajput. He made a very, very important observation. Great institutions are built by great individuals. I think this needs a little more elaboration. If institutions decline, they decline because the successors don't have that kind of quality. And Dr. Sanjay Baru said, among others, the teachers themselves are to be blamed for the growing influence of bureaucrats, politicians. It is absolutely true in the case of appointment of vice chancellors. They lobby, they go and wait in attendance, even to meet an undersecretary or a section officer. They do everything that is unbecoming of a dignified teacher. And this is the fall. Where is Radhakrishnan? Where is all other outstanding vice chancellors, even under colonial times? And what is the status of vice chancellors today? Who, I am only quoting Professor Anandakrishnan, they pay 4 crores to become a vice chancellor in a state university and 8 to 10 crores to become a vice chancellor of a central university. Now, in this kind of situation, what could be the solution to put some academic blood into academics themselves? Thank you.
Yeah, oh, you don't have students here. Well, I was, I guess this question has some relevance to what I was saying. The point I'm making is that unless the academic community itself fights for institutional autonomy, for professional excellence, nobody else outside will fight that fight for you. So it's a responsibility of the teaching community across the country. No one else will stand up for university autonomy unless the teachers stand up for university autonomy. The fact is that there's been a decline in the quality of leadership, both at the bureaucratic and political level, both at the national and the state level. You look at the kind of ministers for education that we have had, not just in the recent past, going back over the last couple of decades. I mean, there was once a time when you had Nurul Hasan as a minister for education. Even Narasimha Rao was a minister for education. These are all learned people. They read books, they wrote books. And today, you know, the last few years, we have a series of people who the academic community hardly is able to admire and respect. But unless the academic community is able to assert its professional interests, who else will do it? You know, I do think the time has come for the university community to mobilize itself for greater institutional autonomy, for liberation from the bureaucracy. There's been some new report. I've not read the report. I've just seen newspaper reports on new education policy. I have no idea whether they've discussed this issue. But this is a crisis. I'm telling you, this is a serious crisis. And I've said this many times before, that the threat from China for us is not in the field of military conflict. There will never be a war with China. But China has already defeated India in the field of intellectual achievements, in science, in the even in the liberal arts, in a wide range of areas of scholarship. The distance that universities there have traveled is so far beyond the distance that universities here have traveled. So I think really we have come to a point where a major movement for improvement in the quality of higher education, in greater freedom for universities from political and governmental interference, is very, very urgently needed across the country. That's why I made it very clear, I'm not blaming any one political party. Today in this country, every political party is in power somewhere or the other. There isn't one state in which there is no major political party that's not in power. And you look at the country. Across this nation, higher education has been destroyed by bureaucratic and political interference. The days of university autonomy are long gone. So I thought this is a good opportunity for me to make the point that this is a recent phenomenon. It's only in the last 15, 20 years that we see this crisis. It's a very serious crisis. You know, I tried to quantify it. You look at the amount of money Indians are spending on going abroad. The last number I saw was in the range of $3 billion per year. $3 billion per year is spent by Indians paying fees in Australia, New Zealand, United States, UK, Singapore, across the world to buy education. Imagine if those 3 billion were spent here. What is the educational budget of the government of India is not even $1 billion, right? So we are in fact seeing a serious crisis. And I think unless the academic community stands up for itself, no one else will.
I would make only one or two points. Okay. In 1922, Mahatma Gandhi wrote a letter. And that letter said, even if Swaraj comes tomorrow, our people will get no happiness. Four things will come heavily upon them. And what he mentioned was, burden of governance, tyranny of the rich, and defects of elections. I asked several people, how did he know about defects of elections? And somebody explained to me, he had studied the British election system very thoroughly, and he could anticipate what would ruin the country after independence, number one. I was the first chairperson of NCT. I don't feel very comfortable when this introduction is given anywhere about me. I was part of the committee to which Mr. Dr. Varu has referred to. It was a wonderful combination. There were four IAS officers, and Professor Rajput was also one added to that group of four. But now there are two reports. One is a report of 217 pages submitted by the committee, which has been leaked out by certain elements. Government has not brought it on the website. Government has brought out a report of 43 pages, which is also available. But the report to which I was a party, we have very specifically said, it is the people who matter. You cannot bring politics in the appointment of vice chancellors. Review the whole thing thoroughly and see that the decline is checked at least to some extent by bringing in the right people. I do not find that in the 43-page report. Having spent 5 years in the ministry, as joint secretary, joint education advisor, and then another 10 years in NCT, 5 and 5 in NCRT, I can tell you, in the ministry we know, this autonomy is a myth. It has no meaning. It has no relevance. Once in the NCT, I changed the designation of deputy secretaries who were posted as head of offices in the four regional offices. I thought vice chancellor, education secretaries will not even meet deputy secretaries. So I changed the name to regional director. No financial implication. And for one whole year, the ministry corresponded with me that you have no right. Because I knew the ministry, I said, I have the right to change it. So long I don't bring burden on you. Anyway, that's not very important. The important factor is, and there's the last point, this issue came up that IGNU should go to UGC for sanction and approval, etc. It is shocking indeed. And I have attended one or two meetings of our board of management. I had very clearly said that IGNU must exercise its right to protest, and I would be very happy. I would be in the forefront to say that there is no business for UGC to go to any other organization, for the IGNU to go to any other organization for approval, etc. You see, you had a distance education council, you had a university which is recognized. How many people will praise UGC outside India as compared to those who praise the IGNU and its contributions? Kapil ne shayad suna ho, mujhe to koi mila nahi jisne bahar UGC ka koi zikr kiya ho, aur kiya hai to negative hi kiya hai. Anyway, Yeah, this is a shameful state of affairs that exists, and I'm sure somebody somewhere will find out a reasonable person who would change it. Well, it depends on how do we go ahead, how do we do it. Friends, the decline of quality in higher education must be, in the major portion, our own responsibility. It is the professional doctors, senior doctors, who go and approve the medical colleges. It is the teacher educators of repute who go and approve B.Ed. colleges. We have no infrastructure. We have no business to blame others. First, we must look into ourselves, into our own system. Thank you very much.
अब हम आज के कार्यक्रम को आगे बढ़ाते हैं।
On the occasion of the 21st G. Ram Reddy Memorial Lecture, we feel privileged to release two reports titled Three Decades of Distance Education
and दूर शिक्षा के तीन दशक
Nurturing Social Equity
दूर शिक्षा के माध्यम से सामाजिक समरसता के प्रयास
May I now request Professor T.O. Fulzile, Director Planning, to give us a brief about the reports.
Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Ravindra Kumar, esteemed Chief Guest, Professor J.S. Rajput, Member BOM IGNO, Dr. Sanjay Baru, Member Governing Board Center for Policy Research, Professor Vayunandan, Chairman for this organizing committee, Sri Sudhir Buddha Kotiji, Registrar Administration, ladies and gentlemen. The planning division plays a vital role in setting the vision and direction for the university's open and distance education system and formulate the short-term and long-term plans, policies, procedures to operationalize the various programs and activities of the university. It is also responsible for preparing strategic plans, which includes five-year plans of the university, and coordinates in designing development and delivering the academic programs. In the light of this, after my joining as a director for planning and development division, I felt the need of consolidated information in one place, because I used to get the RTI, parliament questions, request from various authorities, letters from various ministries like HRD, Social Welfare Ministry, Health Ministry, and Minority Ministry. They want various type of information like SC, ST, women, employed, unemployed. And that data, I find that I'm not getting in one place. And that is why I was very much interested to have a data in one place. And therefore, I requested our former Vice Chancellor, Professor Nageshwar Rao, and I'll explain all these difficulties. And he readily agreed that, yes, you go and prepare the one place information. I told him that there will be so mistake, but he said that let it be a mistake, but put it all the data in one place. And that is why today we have two volumes. As they told that the three decades of distance education. In this publication, year-wise, school-wise, and program-wise data is given since its inception of the university. That is, the data contains from 1986-87 to 2014-15. And the data is also, admission trend is also given, and statistical analysis is also given. That statistical analysis is also given in graphs and charts. So that it is very interesting. As and when you read, you will feel very happy. And second publication is, as they told, that Nurturing the Social Equity Through Distance Education. This volume is analysis of the social profile of the various categories of the IGNO students from the year 1998-99 to 2014-15. in which attempt has been made to consolidate that of university to span the entire spectrum in relation to the socio school wise, program wise, category wise, that is SC, ST, OBC, gender wise, male, female, area wise, urban, rural, tribal, employed, unemployed, and disabled. All these data is now consolidated in one report that is from 1998-99 to 2014-15. I'm sure that these two volumes will work as a valuable source of information for educational professionals, administrators, teachers, academics, researchers, students, and it will be very useful for our own use also for our further plans and expansion. Friends, these two volumes may be, there may be many gaps, many mistakes. I request you, after getting these volumes, kindly tell your suggestions so that we will be improve these volumes in next time, and we have decided these volumes will be revised, updated after every 2 years. Means that all the four semesters data will be included, and it will be keep on updating these volumes. Secondly, again, two volumes are under pipeline, that is RC-wise and study center-wise data since the inception of the university. Second volume is pass out percentage of the students program-wise since the inception of the university. If you have any suggestions in this regard, we will accept it and we'll include it. We'll try to do it. Sir, I would like to take this opportunity to express my thanks to our former Vice Chancellor, Professor Nageshwar Rao, who gave the approval and motivated us to develop, create these volumes. And I also express my gratitude to our Vice Chancellor, Professor Ravindra Kumar, who encouraged us and arranged for a publication release immediately in such a big program in a short time. And I also express my thanks to Registrar MPDT, Professor Sahani, for getting these volumes printed urgently from the printer. His team was there yesterday, and somehow we managed that volumes are ready with us for its release. Lastly, I appreciate the efforts made by my colleagues, that is Dr. Neelam Chaudhary and Mr. Girija Shankar, who has done all this, who has taken a lot of pain for doing all these jobs. I request them to come over the stage for a minute. Girija Shankar. Okay. I request them to. Thank you very much.
May I now request our Honorable Vice Chancellor and Professor J.S. Rajput to release the two publications. Three Decades of Distance Education and Nurturing Social Equity Through Distance Education. Thank you.
अब धीरे धीरे कार्यक्रम अपने अंत की ओर बढ़ रहा है और अंत में हम अपने अतिथियों का आभार एक स्मृति चिन्ह भेंट करके करते रहे हैं, ताकि हम एक विश्वविद्यालय के रूप में, एक संस्थान के रूप में सदा उनकी स्मृतियों में जुड़े रहें। मैं अनुरोध करूंगी मिसेस रेड्डी से कि वे मंच पर आएं, और सबसे पहले मैं अनुरोध करूंगी प्रोफेसर उमा मेदुरु जी से कि वे मंच पर आएं, एक छोटा सा तोहफा भेंट करके मैम का सम्मान करें। अब मैं अनुरोध करूंगी आदरणीय कुलपति जी से कि वे हमारे आज के मुख्य अतिथि डॉक्टर जे एस राजपूत को शॉल व स्मृति चिन्ह भेंट कर सम्मानित करें। अब मैं अनुरोध करूंगी हमारे आज के मुख्य अतिथि तथा प्रबंधन बोर्ड के सदस्य प्रोफेसर जे एस राजपूत से कि वे शॉल व स्मृति चिन्ह भेंट कर हमारे आज के वक्ता डॉक्टर संजय बारू जी का आभार व्यक्त करें। आप सभी का आभार। धन्यवाद सर। आई वुड टेक दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी टू कॉल अपॉन प्रोफेसर वायु नंदन टू द डायस, हु हैज समथिंग स्पेशल टू शेयर विद डॉक्टर संजय बारू, सम ओल्ड मेमोरीज टू ऐड टू द चार्म एंड बेनेवोलेंस ऑफ दिस डे।
I want a small surprise for Sanjay Baru. I think it goes back to 33 years back, Usman University Arts College Students Union valedictory function. I think Sanjay Baru, maybe, he was our chief guest. 1982 June, see, that was the association which had student office bearers from different ideological backgrounds. One was from Akhil Bharat Vidyadi Parishad, and one was from RS, Radical Students Union, and one was All India Students Federation, and other was Student Federation of India. So there was no consensus to, you know, I mean, to get a chief guest for the inauguration. Then ultimately there was no inauguration, but when the association came for an end, then we said we'll at least have a valedictory. Someone said Gadar ko bulayenge. Someone said Professor Harugopal. So ultimately the consensus was for Sanjay Baru. So he was, I think that time was a reader in the University of Hyderabad. It is all, I think, 33 years back. So just I wanted to a small surprise to him as a remembrance. I think a small, I think it's a black and white, one of my Yeah. Thank you. So I told this to my Vice Chancellor, Professor Ravindra Kumar. Sir, chota sa ye karna hai. No, 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 aap jo karna hai, kar do. So thank you, Professor Ravindra Kumar. Thank you very much. Thank you.
और अंत में मैं आमंत्रित करना चाहूंगी हमारे विश्वविद्यालय के कुलसचिव श्री सुधीर बोटाकोटी जी को कि वे यहाँ आए और धन्यवाद ज्ञापन करें।
With permission of the honorable chair, I on behalf of the IGNU family express our gratitude for the Vice Chancellor Professor Ravindra Kumar ji for gracing the occasion. Sir, aapki prerna se hi ye samarah safaltapurvak sampann ho paya. हम कृतज्ञ हैं प्रोफेसर जे एस राजपूत जी का कि उन्होंने अपनी उपस्थिति से इस अवसर की गरिमा बढ़ाई. आवर ग्रैटिट्यूड टू डॉक्टर संजय बारू फॉर एनलाइटनिंग टॉक ऑन लीडरशिप with its relative quality and context. Sir, your expression with conviction could present many issues in different, rather more right perspective. We all feel blessed in presence of Srimati Primala Rama Reddy. We all pray for her good health and long life. Professor Rama Reddy, the founder of IGNU, the founder VC of the Indira Gandhi National Open University, he had a vision. Prarabdh acha tha, ek sanskriti janmi, process or result, process safal raha, aur parinam sukad. We should take inspiration from our past glories and endeavor for achieving the vistas in education, particularly ODL system. I thank the teachers, the officers, academic and non-teaching staff for their presence, for their participation in this occasion. We appreciate the contribution of the organizing committee, the EMPC, the support staff from all facets of IGNU life in organizing this event. With this, I thank you all again.
As we come to the end of a memorable day, I thank all of you for being a part of today's memorial lecture. कार्यक्रम को सफल बनाने के लिए आप सभी का धन्यवाद.